In this video, we're going to take a closer look at advanced applications of Coulomb's law. Remember that Coulomb's law says the magnitude of the electric force between two charges, Q1 and Q2, equals a constant number, we'll call it K, times the absolute value of the charge Q1 times the charge Q2, all divided by the distance between Q1 and Q2, we'll call it R squared. The constant number K equals 9 times 10 to the 9th Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared. What if we want to know the electric force on a charge due to multiple other charges? In this example, Q1, Q2, and Q3 are all in a line on the x-axis, and we're told the charge of each one. Knowing electric force has both magnitude and direction, what is the net electric force on the middle charge, Q2? To find out, we need to compute the electric force on Q2 due to Q1, the electric force on Q2 due to Q3, and then add them together to solve for the total electric force. Using Coulomb's law, the electric force magnitude of Q1 and Q2 equals K times the absolute value of Q1 times Q2, divided by the distance between Q1 and Q2, R squared. Plugging in 9 times 10 to the 9th Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared for K, 2 times 10 to the negative 10th Coulombs for Q1, negative 4.5 times 10 to the negative 13th Coulombs for Q2, and 1.50 meters for R, we find that the electric force for magnitude of Q1 on Q2 is 3.6 times 10 to the negative 13th Newtons. Since Q1 and Q2 have opposite signs, they attract one another. That means Q1 pulls Q2 in the negative x direction. The next step is to figure out the electric force magnitude of Q3 on Q2. Plugging in for K, 9 times 10 to the 9th Newton meters squared, divided by Coulomb squared, negative 5 times 10 to the negative 9th Coulomb for Q3, negative 4.5 times 10 to the negative 13th Coulombs for Q2, and 2.0 meters for R, we find the electric force magnitude of Q3 on Q2 is 5.1 times 10 to the negative 12th Newtons. Since Q3 and Q2 have the same sign, they push one another away. This means Q3 pushes Q2 in the negative x direction. The last step to finding the net electric force on Q2 is to add these two forces together. Since electric force is a vector quantity, and the forces both point in the negative x direction, we find the net magnitude by adding the individual magnitudes together. The force of Q1 on Q2, negative 3.6 times 10 to the negative 13th newtons, plus the force of Q3 on Q2, negative 5.1 times 10 to the negative 12th newtons, equals negative 5.5 times 10 to the negative 12th newtons, or 5.5 times 10 to the negative 12th newtons, pointing in the negative x direction. Now let's study another example, where this time three charges are arranged at the corners of an equilateral triangle, with sides 75 centimeters long. Once again, we're given the charges of Q1, Q2, and Q3. We want to know, what is the net electric force on Q2, the charge at the top of the triangle? The net electric force on Q2 will be the sum of the forces Q1 and Q3 exert on Q2. Let's start with Q1. We can find the magnitude of the electric force Q1 exerts on Q2 using Coulomb's law. The force equals K, 9 times 10 to the 9th Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared, times absolute value of Q1, 2 times 10 to the negative 10th Coulombs, times Q2, negative 4.5 times 10 to the negative 12th Coulombs, all divided by the distance between Q1 and Q2, R, or 0.75 meters squared. Plugging in these numbers gives us 1.4 times 10 to the negative 11th Newtons. Now, in what direction does the force point? Since Q1 and Q2 have opposite charges, we know the force between them is attractive. Since we will add this force to another one later on, what we'd really like to know is the amount of this force when it is broken up into its components in the x and y directions. We can use the fact that drawing a vertical line from Q2 down to the x-axis creates a 30, 60, 90 triangle. What we want to find is the x and y components of the electrical force of Q1 acting on Q2, which we call F sub x and F sub y. The fact that we have a special right triangle lets us solve for f sub x and f sub y using ratios. The two triangles in this diagram are similar. That means the ratio of the total force of Q1 on Q2 to the x component of that force is equal to 2 divided by 1. Multiplying both sides of the equation by f sub x and dividing both sides by 2 shows that f sub x equals 1.4 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons divided by 2, which equals 7.0 times 10 to the negative 12th newtons in a negative x direction. Now, let's solve for f sub y a similar way using a ratio. Going back to our similar triangles, the total electric force of Q1 on Q2 divided by f sub y equals 2 divided by the square root of 3. To solve for f sub y, first we multiply both sides by f sub y, then multiply both sides by the square root of 3 divided by 2. The force of Q1 on Q2 in the negative y direction equals 1.4 times 10 to the negative 11th times the square root of 3 over 2, which equals 1.2 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons in the negative y direction. We've found the x and y components of the force of Q1 on Q2. We're halfway there to solving for the total electric force on Q2 in this charge distribution. The third charge, Q3, also exerts a force on Q2. Just like with Q1, we'll solve for the magnitude and direction of that force. By Coulomb's law, the magnitude of the force of Q3 on Q2 is K, 9 times 10 to the 9th newton meter squared per Coulomb squared, times the absolute value of Q2, negative 4.5 times 10 to the negative 12th Coulombs, times Q3, negative 5 times 10 to the negative 10th Coulombs, divided by the distance between the charges, R23, or 0.75 meters squared. This equals 3.6 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons. That's the magnitude of the electric force of Q3 acting on Q2. Since Q3 and Q2 both have negative charges, they repel each other. The force on Q2 points away from Q3. Once again, we'll use our 30-60-90 triangle to find out the force components. We'll let f sub x be the x component of the force, and f sub y be the y component. Solving first for f sub x, we see from the similar triangles that the total force of Q3 on Q1, 3.6 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons, divided by f sub x, equals 2 divided by 1. Multiplying both sides by f sub x, and dividing both sides by 2, we find that f sub x equals 3.6 times 10 to the negative 11th, divided by 2, which is 1.8 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons in the negative x direction. To solve for f sub y, we'll use the fact that 3.6 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons divided by f sub y equals 2 divided by the square root of 3. Multiplying both sides by f sub y and then by the square root of 3 divided by 2 shows us that f sub y equals 3.6 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons times the square root of 3 divided by 2, which equals 3.12 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons in the positive y direction. Now we are ready to solve for the total magnitude and direction of the electric force on Q2 from Q1 and Q3. We'll use this table to add up the x and y components. To find the total force on Q2 in the x direction, we add up the x components of the force of Q1 on Q2 and Q3 on Q2. This equals 2.5 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons in the negative x direction. To find the total force on Q2 in the y direction, we add up the y components of the force of Q1 on Q2 and of Q3 on Q2. This equals 1.92 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons in the positive y direction. Using the Pythagorean theorem, we can take the square root of the sum of the squares of these components to find the magnitude of the net force on Q2. The square root of negative 2.5 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons squared plus 1.92 times 10 to the negative 11th squared equals 3.2 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons. That's the magnitude of the total force on Q2. The direction of this net force is found using the tangent function. The angle the force forms with the positive x-axis, we'll call it theta, equals the arctangent of the sum of the y components of the forces acting on Q2, which is 1.92 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons, divided by the sum of the x components of the forces acting on Q2, which is negative 2.5 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons. The result we find is negative 37.5 degrees, but since the angle lies in the second quadrant, we'll add 180 degrees to that result. 180 degrees plus negative 37.5 degrees equals 142 degrees with respect to the positive x-axis. Let's do one last Coulomb's law exercise, this time with four charges arranged in a quadrilateral. We're given the amount of each charge, and we want to figure out what the total electric force is, magnitude and direction, on charge Q3. We'll need to know how far from Q3 the rest of the charges are, so let's solve for those distances as the first step. The distances in red are the ones we want to figure out: R13, R23, and R43. R13 is already known. It's 75 centimeters, or 0.75 meters. To figure out R23, let's focus on the highlighted triangle. First, we'll solve for the angle marked as theta. We can see that theta plus 117 degrees equals 180 degrees. Subtracting 117 degrees from both sides, theta equals 180 degrees minus 117 degrees, or 63 degrees. Now we can use the sine trigonometric function to solve for R23. Sine theta equals the side opposite the angle, divided by the hypotenuse. Plugging in our values, the sine of 63 degrees equals 60 centimeters divided by R23. After we multiply both sides by R23 and divide both sides by the sine of 63 degrees, we see that R23 equals 67 centimeters. To figure out the last unknown distance, R43, we'll use our sine function again. In this case, the sine of our angle, 28 degrees, equals 31 centimeters divided by R43. After we multiply both sides by R43 and divide both sides by the sine of 28 degrees, we see that R43 equals 66 centimeters. Now that we have the distance between Q3 and the other charges, and the charge values themselves, we can use Coulomb's law to solve for the electric force magnitude between each pair of charges. Remember that Coulomb's law says the electric force magnitude between two charges, Q1 and Q2, equals the constant K times the absolute value of Q1 times Q2, all divided by R, the distance between the charges, squared. This table summarizes what we know about the scenario, and what we want to solve for, the electric force. Starting with the first row of values, we plug these into Coulomb's law and find that the electric force magnitude between Q1 and Q3 is 6.4 times 10 to the negative 10th newtons. We fill that in on the table and move on to the next row, Q2 and Q3. Plugging these values into Coulomb's law, we find that the electric force between Q2 and Q3 is 4.0 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons. Now for the last pair of charges, Q4 and Q3. Coulomb's law tells us that the force between Q4 and Q3 is 4.1 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons. Now we know all the force magnitudes, and just need to figure out their directions. Here, the magnitude and direction of the forces on Q3 are shown. The direction of the arrows depends on whether each pair of charges repels each other, like Q1 and Q3, or attracts each other, like the other two pairs. We want to solve for x and y components of each of these three vectors, so we can add them all together to find the resultant force magnitude and direction. Here's a zoomed-in view of the forces acting on Q3, along with the electric force components we want to solve for. To figure out the x and y components of the forces, we can use the sine and cosine functions. Since we know all the angles involved, all we'll need to do is use sine and cosine of those angles and multiply that by the force magnitude. The table shows what we want to calculate. Let's make all of our angles with respect to the positive x-axis. This will allow us to consistently use the cosine function with our x components and the sine function with our y components. Starting with the top row, since the cosine of 0 degrees is 1 and the sine of 0 degrees is 0, the x component of the force of Q1 on Q3 is 6.4 times 10 to the negative 10th, and the y component is 0. For the x component of the force from Q2 on Q3, 4.0 times 10 to the negative 9th times cosine of 117 degrees equals negative 1.8 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons. The y component equals 4.0 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons times the sine of 117 degrees, which is 3.6 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons. To find the x and y components of the force of Q4 on Q3, multiply the force magnitude, 4.1 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons times the cosine and sine of 62 degrees, respectively. The x component equals 1.9 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons, and the y component equals 3.6 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons. Adding up all the x components and all the y components, we find the total resulting x and y force components acting on charge Q3 to be 7.4 times 10 to the negative 10th newtons in the x direction, and 7.2 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons in the y direction. By the Pythagorean theorem, the total electric force acting on Q3, squared, equals the sum of the x components of force acting on Q3, squared, plus the sum of the y components of force acting on Q3, squared. Taking the square root of both sides of the equation and plugging in the x and y components of the force on Q3, we find that the total electric force on Q3, rounded to two significant figures, equals 7.2 times 10 to the negative 9th newtons. To find the direction the net force points, we can use the fact that the tangent of the angle the force vector makes with the positive x-axis equals the sum of the y components of the forces acting on Q3, divided by the sum of the x components of the forces acting on Q3. If we take the arc tangent of both sides and then plug in the values for f sub y and f sub x, we find that theta, the angle between the net force on Q3 and the positive x-axis, is 84 degrees. That's a closer look at advanced applications of Coulomb's law. For more physics in motion, go to our homepage, where the entire series is available to you.